I will be very short. Actually, I want to thank both Ramona and Olivier for inviting me here, and also allow me to thank Olivier because this is the third year of my PhD and I'm about to submit, and I cannot be more grateful for Olivier's support for these 3 years. So Olivier just gave me the word, donner la parole, we say in French, and this is all about altruism. This is about my research. And I'm just going to give you a brief sketch and adumbration about what I have done these 3 years and focus on only one thing which we have touched upon in these 2 days. My work is called The Journal of a Philosophical Passage to Altruism. And it's a passage because I had the most difficulty in talking about altruism. No matter what I did, I would find arguments. I have to argue about something. I had to convince about something to someone. And I realized that ever since Aristotle and Plato, I don't say Greek thought, because under the metonymy of Greek thought, we usually think all of the ancient Greek thought, and it's a little bit unsettling to say Greek thought when it's only Plato and Aristotle that we have followed. And we have done philosophy driven by knowledge, by a particular and idiosyncratic notion of the term logos, and with arguments. Now, both of these concepts are violent to the other in one way or another, because altruism, as we understand it in an everyday sense, and even in a religion sense, if you will, is all about a free and unfettered movement towards the other, where I go towards and extend myself toward the other rather than trying to convince them about something. And this movement, usually we call it without reserve, sans réserve in French. So the other becomes capital there. We don't have a capital towards the other, but the other becomes another with a capital O. So it doesn't matter who they are, we move towards them. Now this aporia about how to philosophize about altruism motivated me to go back and understand the notion of the argument all the way until the beginning of philosophy. And I landed in the pre-Socratics, and I saw that the argument, the notion of the argument that they have, doesn't mean anything about convincing. It means undertaking. And if I take the literal translation from the ancient Greek into the French or to the English, it would be sur les mains, under the hand. The argument is doing something. That's the actual epihirima is the word, and it's actually taking and doing something with your hands, pretty much the way that Heidegger explains it in Being and Time. So with Plato and Aristotle, we have philosophy, and this undertaking becomes to convince the other. And in Latin, it becomes vincere, to win the other. So there cannot be any altruism in this way about with arguments trying to convince the other. So with an argument, there's always a leader. If I say that, maybe Giovanni could help me, because in the Italian we say duce, right? There's a duce, or a duce in Latin, who always has a logos, who induces, deduces, abduces, or reduces the other under the categories of the same. So any kind of argument has this notion of a leader that goes towards to win the other. And with modern linguists like Martinet, there's always these symbols and signs, the syntagmata, like the regiments of signs that come towards the other in order to capture them. This is the tradition that we have been working, which is against any kind of altruism. And we know that there is altruistic behavior in many aspects of our lives. So I'm asking myself, is there another logos apart from the logos of Aristotle and Plato? And in this exploration that I'm doing, I found Peirce, American pragmatist, who takes a lot of Dan Scotus and from William Ockham and other Scottish philosophers, that they had spotted a distinction in Aristotle that no one had really paid attention. It was two different kind of logics. One logic about what there is, which they called it utilitarian logic because it goes towards being and what there is. And another which is called like the logic of the question of what is given in me in order to be able to talk about it. So in this kind of way, the logic of trying to describe what there is the one which we call today calculus. It's the utens, according to Peirce, who takes it from Dan Scotus. It's utilitarian because it aspires to a conclusion, to conclude what there is, to make a statement, to bring the horizon into a closure. However, the question is what we use in the metaphysical exploration. It's trying to understand and reflect and see what there is. It's what Hannah Arendt calls the admiring, the thaumazing, in terms of philosophizing. So the non-utilitarian logic is the question, which is an undertaking, and I say a quest toward the other, which is a quest that doesn't actually try to close the other under the categories of the same. The question rather touches the other and allows them to be expressed in their own terms. As Olivier did, you question me and you give me the word. It's a promise for the other to express themselves as they are. It's not thinking with a regulating idea or habit, as Peirce calls it, or the feminist calls it, of being, which is a transcendental way of thinking, which will in the end make the other fall under this blade of some representation, how the other is. Rather, the question does not end in the other's becoming an object of representation, but is an invitation, a calling. It is a calling to respond in their own terms, in their words, in other words, otherwise. To call someone is to touch the existence. It is erotic. An erotic without being, though. And an erotic without being is to touch the other without penetrating them, because there is no being in the erotic, as the pre-Socratics thought. It's just question, erotesis, erotic. To question the other comes to be a fall with the other in love rather than a falling in love with the other. It's a falling with the other in love in question. So we question, and the more we question, the more we unfold the other and let them express themselves as they are, the more they have space and time to express themselves. So this fall is an act of loving, not being in love, which, as Yankelevich says, creates a space which invites the other without appropriation or ex-appropriation. And quote, this kind of acting love is a gift. It's the absolute given. It's an invitation to give, and what we give is space and time for the other to express themselves. And that kind of a thing is what the feminists call an allowance for transcendence in their own terms, without reducing them to what we think that they are. This kind of themes of about touching and questioning, which go all the way back from the pre-Socratics to some kind of thread within the medieval philosophy, all the way to existential thought, we can see it with Sartre with the notion of the caress, the hand that traverses the body and creates shivers, because it allows the body to be able to surface all around and communicate in a way which is not representational. It's also in Michel Henry, in Encarnation, where we have an intersubjectivity which relies on the touching, a touching which doesn't conclude. It's an erotic that doesn't come to a termination or an end, which becomes an interobjective. In a fabulous analysis, Michel Henry says in Encarnation that when we have sex, we come to an end alone. The intersubjectivity of the erotic does not end because it doesn't have being. It's a questioning, a constant touching. It's a touching that Derrida describes in Touching Jean-Luc Nancy. It's an exact touching, a touching with contact, a tactful touching. Or a touching with the lips, as Irigaray says in her own works. So my thread towards this kind of notion of touching, which is the questioning, it's a promise which allows the other to be able to express themselves without reducing them with any kind of representation, which could ultimately lead to silence if the representation concludes. Now, this kind of theme, I've also found it in Hume, surprisingly. Many people are surprised when I say that, because what I did is that I took all the examples of Hume. And Hume, whenever he wants to describe what the belief is or what this feeling of affectivity is, he always supposes another. He says, suppose another comes to tell you this. Suppose another comes to tell you that. There's no representation, no faculty of being, no something or some kind of entity which exists in the body, in the brain, or some kind of reification of a thing based on which we think. There's no Hegelian metaphoricity from a body to a mind. There's no such distinction. It's something that takes the expression of life where the other is always already there, if I take this Heideggerian notion. It's not some kind of notion of starting with yourself and trying to find the other, as Sartre says, well, you will never find them. It's creating a relation by questioning, by bringing the other to yourself. So my, it will sound strange, but as my research is all about questioning, it always ends with a question, not with a conclusion. So there's no conclusion or argument in any of my research. It's an opportunity to say that if this is something that appeals to someone, why do we engage still in representations and we do philosophy within a way that actually reduces, appropriates, or exappropriates the other?